Well, they tell me I've made more videos than anyone else on CMT. And boy, do I have some stories to tell. So please join me for my video Bible. Making the video, Whoever's in New England, was very exciting for me because it was brand new to our industry. Other genres of music had been making the videos, but it was my first, so that's what I was concerned about because it was brand new to me, and I was very proud of Whoever's in New England video.
You spend an awful lot of time in Massachusetts. Seems like every other week you've got a meeting waiting there. Business must be booming, or could something else?
Yeah, well, we did have our went to blows the first day, I think. She came to New York City, and we went shopping at Bloomingdale's, and couldn't find a one thing. Nothing worked. So pretty funny to me. So we argued about her jeans. You know, her jeans were really, really long, almost touching the ground. And I showed her the styles that people are wearing were really much, much shorter. And she, like, you know, looked at me like, hey, I'm from Oklahoma, and this is how we wear our pants. And I remember I probably answered saying, but we're in New York City. We don't wear our pants like that. And she just, but she won.
It was kind of funny that John Small had a vision for my clothes to be one thing, and I was another. They had this beautiful green sweater that they wanted me to wear, which I fell in love with it. And then they wanted me to wear slacks. And I said, I'll go for the sweater, but I don't want to wear the slacks. Let me wear my boots and my jeans, because that's me. And so we went back and forth with it, but we all compromised, and I got to wear my jeans and boots and their beautiful sweater.
When whoever's in New England's through with you.
To New England and into Boston because mainly we wanted it to be a winter video and snow. Well, there wasn't any snow there. I mean, there was just, it spit snow. I mean, that's all there was. And they were raking snow up for the scene where we were in the park right across from the hotel we were staying at. And we did that little scene with the guy who played my husband, and he was trying to throw snowballs, and all the crew was gathering up as much snow as they possibly could find for him to throw something.
Your bags and left them in the hallway. But before you leave again, there's just one thing you ought to know. When the icy wind blows through you, remember that it's me who feels so cold.
The first time I saw it, I was watching HBO. And the movie had just finished, and getting ready before the next movie came on, they started playing videos. And Aretha Franklin's video was on, and I was watching her, and all of a sudden it went off, and Whoever's in New England went on. And I was like, yes, I've made it. I'm right behind Aretha Franklin. So, gosh, I was set. I knew that was the first start of the big time. I was thrilled beyond words when the video won an award at the CMAs for Video of the Year. That's, you know, when you make a video, you're hoping it's going to be more than just seen by everybody. You hope it will win an award. So that was the icing on the cake. What Am I Going to Do About You was a very sad song, very emotional, beautiful song. And so John Small worked with him again, and he had the idea to go to Central Park. Bill Carter, my manager at the time, was trying to get someone, an actor, to work with me in this video. So he knew David Keith. The only problem was David Keith was in Greece or somewhere in Europe, and he was shooting a movie over there. So time was getting, you know, a little time crunch there. And so Bill Carter said, well, let's fly him back over on the Concorde. And I said, great, what's the Concorde? And so, well, it's a plane that flies from, you know, Europe to over to New York in like 3 hours. I said, oh, my gosh, that's great. And so we flew him over. And he was, I mean, we were ready to say action, not thinking he's going to show up. But he did right at the very last minute. Officer and a Gentleman was a huge smash box office hit, and I'd watched him in that, was a huge fan, so I was thrilled to get to work with him. We had a real fun time shooting the football scene, because John Small's wife Janine is in it, my bus driver at the time Larry Jones is in it, my bass guitar player Roger Wills is in it, and then a guy that I know that needs to be in movies, and I can't talk him into it. My husband and manager, Narvel Blackstock, is in that movie, in the video, wearing the blue striped shorts.
We started to play football, and this guy could throw a ball at 150 yards. And what happened was, the day turned into this fun day of football. And that, so it actually gave me a lot of motivation to what to shoot. And then we shot a lot of football scenes in the scene because of that.
There's a lot of things that happened during the shoot of What Am I Gonna Do About You that was not planned for. We came down one morning and one of the trucks had been broken into and a lot of the equipment had been stolen. So thank God we were in New York where it was very easy to go rent some other equipment. And another thing that happened, we were supposed to film that day on a beautiful sunny day, and I mean the clouds just were dark and black, and they opened up and just poured on us. And so John said, get out the umbrellas, start down there, walk towards the camera. And we made it into a scene where it worked out great.
One of the cool things about Reba is that she's very driven. You could find her standing in the corner with her head down. I don't want to move, so I'll be out of focus, but she'd put her head down and she'd go, it's worth it, it's worth it, it's worth it, it's worth it. She would pump herself up to do the shot or do it. Because I would work her a long time, be many, many hours and many, many takes of making it work. And she'd be the one that'd be pushing herself.
You know, because this video was not a resolved ending, you know, you don't know what she's going to do, I think she moved away and found somebody totally different. It wasn't the David Keith character. It wasn't the guy in the office. She said, no, I've tried that. I'm going to go somewhere else. I think she married a veterinarian in Omaha.
In the summer of 1945, I was 9 years old.
Sunday Kind of Love was a song that I had been in love with for a while. Mama always listened, you know, to music a lot, and I knew probably more about the older songs than I did the current songs playing on the radio. And Sunday Kind of Love was always a favorite of mine, and I had heard it done by several different artists. And so it was just a song I wanted to record, fell in love with it.
Reba McEntire.
Love. Jack Cole is very famous for what they used to call, when you said Jack Cole, they'd say mini movies. And his videos were very detailed, very intricate, and he liked to put a lot of dialogue in them. And so this was the first video for me that had any dialogue in it. I wasn't speaking, but it was other characters in the video did. Jack Cole came to me with the idea of doing the World War II scenario, putting it back in an era with the outfits, the dress, the hair, the makeup. Linda DeMith worked hard, long hours on my false eyelashes and the wig that I wore. And I really got a big kick out of it. It was a very fun video to do.
And we used the Hermitage Hotel because it was probably the largest room available with a sense and a feel of that old ballroom style. A lot of marble for a dance floor, deep focus in the background. We could set up stages there and really recreate the sense of a 40s big band ballroom. And the Hermitage gave us that with sort of the ambiance that we loved to do her performance.
Oh, the 40s are always very romantic. With the movies I've seen, hearing my mom talk about it, very romantic. I love doing period pieces. I like the outfits from the eras, whether they're Westerns, they're World War II. You know, I've done quite a few different era videos, so I thoroughly enjoy it.
Tuesdays
The director impresses me when he comes to me with an idea and a concept that is just like, wow, I wouldn't have ever thought of that, because I usually go with the storyline of the song. And when they come from left field and come up with a video concept that is, that connects so well, but with something I hadn't thought of, and hopefully nobody else will either. And when they watch the video, it gives them another aspect of where that song can go. And so when I got the chance to sing Kathy's Clown, the melody of that has always been so haunting. So it's a beautiful melody. I absolutely love singing it.
They called and said, would you like to do this video? It's for, she's redoing the old Everly Brothers song, which I always loved. And I said, yeah, why not?
You know you've got to stand tall.
Red Steagall, who discovered me, had a production company. And so we all got together and went out to L.A. and worked on one of the studios out there. And we talked Bruce Boxleitner into being Sheriff Dillon, and I played Miss Kitty. And it was a lot of fun. We just absolutely had a blast. The only bad thing about the whole video was I had to wear a corset and still act like I was singing. And that was the most uncomfortable thing I can, that was pure torture. I can't imagine women wearing those corsets around every day with those big dresses on in the heat of summer.
And then I found out I'm the guy that's the clown. The guy everyone's making fun of when he walks in the saloon, and they're all laughing at me. So I identified with that.
Jim Hammond, my tour manager that we lost in 91, the plane crash, he played the bartender. So it's very emotional when we get to watch Kathy's Clown now, to see Jim as the bartender. He's not with us anymore, but we have him in film. And I'm the one who cares. Johnny Crawford, I've been a big fan of his for many years, from The Rifleman. But Jerry Potter and Buck Taylor and a bunch of the old guys from the cowboy western TV shows and movies agreed to be in the video, and they were a blast to work with. I mean, when we weren't filming, we were all huddled over in a corner talking and visiting and having a great time. When I was growing up, I was such a huge tomboy, and I wanted to live in the western, you know, but before automobiles and telephone. And about right the days when they had, you know, Pony Express would have been right down my alley. So for me to play Miss Kitty was a far stretch, because I would have been not Miss Kitty. I don't know, that's a pretty good gig, I guess. Treatment and loved it, and we shot it just, you know, out by Cool Springs, close to Franklin, here right outside of Nashville. The bad part of it was like July the 3rd. It was so hot, and I was back when I had my big hair, and oh gosh, it was hot. And we were out in the fields, and I, being from Oklahoma, I just knew I was going to get ticks and chiggers all over me, and it was hot and dusty. And the guy that played my love interest was really good working with the horses. He's very good looking, and it was a very romantic, strong woman video with a lot of conflict, heated tempers, and things going wrong. You lie. plan that he got bucked off, or did that just happen? I don't think that was a planned thing, because he was, you know, trying to work the horse, and then he got on him, was riding him. But it really worked out well for the video. It's not good for him that he got bucked off, but it was really good for the video. The things, when we were in the barn and the horses tied up and we're walking back and forth and saying stuff, it was anything silly that we could think up to say to each other that we knew wouldn't hurt each other's feelings. So we didn't want to say, well, you're goofy and your oatmeal's mushy, or anything. You know, we were just trying to think up stuff that wouldn't hurt each other's feelings, but still have that look in our eyes of, we're not happy here. Things aren't working. Of You Lie, I was very pleased it had horses in it and it was in a ranch setting, because that's where I grew up. That was southeastern Oklahoma on a cattle ranch. We had horses all the time. So it was back to my raising that I was really glad. I got to ride a horse in it and being around one, so it was, that's why I think I fell in love with the concept.
I just can't believe it. I mean, fancy Ray Baker riding in my cab. It's some kind of weather we haven't any fancy. I'll tell you what, I've seen every movie you've ever made, and my wife Louise, she's got every record you ever made. Fancy Ray Baker, my goodness. You know, I really didn't know you was from this area. But I'll tell you what, I think
fancy.
You are the most famous person to ever come from these parts.
Fancy.
But you just passing through, you're gonna stay for a while.
No, I'm sorry, what'd you say?
I said, are you just passing through, or you gonna stay for a while?
No, I'm just passing through.
Louise is not gonna believe this. Fancy Ray Baker in my cab. No, you might want me to wait. This ain't necessarily the best neighborhood.
No, I'll be a while.
Oh, well, that's no problem. I won't even keep the meter running.
Okay, thanks.
Fancy is a young lady whose parents were not in good financial standing, to say the least. They were almost starving to death. And so her mother had the idea of dressing her up and having her taken care of. And so it never really tells in the video that she became a prostitute. That kind of is what was implied in the song all the time. But she was a kept woman, and I guess taken care of for the services that she rendered.
She came back too late, and she comes back to the house where she was born in, and relives just after the funeral of her mother. She relives the memories. Now it's time to sell off the place. And she sort of has to reconcile this baggage that she's been carrying with her, and in a way say goodbye to her mother, maybe for the last time, so that she could get on with her own life.
She survived. Her mama died. Daddy ran off, and the baby was taken care of by the welfare. And for her to be able to conquer and to survive, I think makes it a very, very strong woman's song, video, story, and one that I was very proud of to be a part of.
She handed me a heart she blocked if it said to thine own self be true. It sounded like somebody else who was talking, asking, Mama, what do I do? She said, just be nice to the gentleman, Fancy. They'll be nice to you. She said, here's your one chance, Fancy, don't let me down. Here's your one chance, Fancy, don't let me down. Lord, forgive me for what I do, but if you won't, I would
ask me all the time, what's your favorite song that I've ever gotten to record? And I always say Fancy. And then they'll say, what's your favorite video? That's harder to do because I've done quite a few videos and I've got to work with some really neat people in the videos. But Fancy Because of the Song is one of my favorite videos.
I'm proud that I was able to help take the song and give it a visual extension, a classic piece of truth in your video. And it's hard to do that in a video. You can look at it 5 years later and still be moved.
We shot the video, I think, around Franklin, Tennessee, south of Nashville, and it was cold. It was really, it was drizzling, it was damp. And I took my bus to the set so I could get in and warm up every once in a while. If the bus was too far off, we just get back in that old house. And in some of the scenes, you'll notice that when I'm singing, there's fog coming out of my mouth. And they kept saying, well, put an ice cube in your mouth and you won't, you know, it won't blow fog. But I'm freezing out here. I don't want to put ice in my mouth. Outside where I had to walk around by the tombstones, which, by the way, were made out of styrofoam. Every time I'd walk, my heels, or the high heels, would just kind of sink right into the little soggy ground. But the lockets that said, to thine own self be true, after the video was out, we sold them in the fan club, and we had lockets made up. And that was a big thing. The fans loved that.
Okay, Mama. I understand.
I've always been a firm believer that if you don't love yourself, how can other people love you? And so you got to be true to yourself. And then if you're honest with yourself and love yourself and feel good about yourself, that makes you an inline person. You can go out and face the world. Maggie is a woman who is like a lot of women all over the United States, probably all over the world, who is dealing with having to work to help support the family, who has children at home, who's always wondering, is there more to this world and to my life than what I'm living in and now existing in? Although she's happy with her family, she loves her children, her husband. Beautiful. She's just wondering, is there life out there? Is there life out there?
So much she hasn't done. Those who are not responsible enough to be on time should not waste mine.
We were all discussing on who could play my husband in the video, Is There Life Out There? And we couldn't come up with anybody that everybody agreed on. And so Huey Lewis was on Arsenio Hall. And I said, hey, Norval, let's get Huey to come in and play that. And he looked over at me and he said, yeah, right, like Huey's got the time to come do this.
How you feeling?
So the next day we were talking to Jack Cole back in Nashville, and Jack said, you're not going to believe it. Guess who I got to play the part of your husband? I said, who? He said, Huey Lewis. I was like, oh, my gosh. Supposed to happen. To live for
today. I was asked, I don't remember exactly. I mean, her people got in touch with my people. And I was living in Montana at the time. And the couple people that work for me there are Reba McEntire fanatics. And so when I mentioned it, they said, oh, you got to do this. And so I said, yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Well, the scene where her son and daughter get in a scuffle and they knock the coffee cup over on the papers that she has been working on for so long. And then Huey comes in and shakes her and he says, Maggie, don't say that, because she says something real hurtful to her daughter. And she learns that words are very hurtful. She learns that family is very important and that no matter what happens, that family comes first. And that she learned that she shouldn't have said that to her daughter. That if her daughter was a mistake, wasn't a planned birth, to have her, that it all turned out very well and that she's very glad that her daughter is with her now.
Working on that piece for 3 weeks now. Why did you do that?
I didn't mean to. I'm sorry, Mommy. It was an accident.
I don't need any more accidents in my life.
Hey. Time out, Maggie. All along, you know, the director and Reba had really taken a kind of a movie, a film approach to it.
Graduation.
And they claim that's why they'd asked, asked me to do it and so on. And that was the feeling on the set all the time anyway. So I know that was, I mean, I don't know if they intended to have that part in the middle or not, but you could tell they really wanted to make a statement with the video.
Once again, we got a lot of flack because they were saying this is the Jack Cole mini movie and we shouldn't have put so much dialogue. It's getting away from the basic idea, the basic song, the flow of the song. And again, I thought it just added to it. You know, the song even stops there for a little bit while the dialogue takes place. I thought it just enhanced it.
O'Connor, may I see you a moment?
My decision was to take it to the next level. The song would be used as an emotional subtext to the storyline. And the storyline that I created was a blue-collar woman struggling to bring up two children, whose husband was on the edge of non-work, struggling to survive to make the family work, and her decision to go back to school to better her life.
Learned more from the stains than I did the paper. After the video was released and the single, and after, you know, the single had charted and it went to number one, and then a little while later we got some interest in Los Angeles to do a movie about Is There Life Out There? And so we did a television movie, and it was the first time and not the last time that we'd gone from song video to a movie. And so that's been working very well for me since then, but that was the first to happen.
You know, I don't know how, if people can know how personable she is. I mean, she's really nice, you know. She's knows exactly where she is and where everybody is, and, you know, very generous that way, and in terms of the crew and everything else, so very professional.
Some new facts in the old Brody murder case.
Well, in the song, That's Not the Lights Went Out in Georgia was about a girl and her brother. But it's basically he's coming back into town and his wife has been cheating. Well, his so-called best friend tells him about her cheating on him, and he gets mad and he goes home and he finds her dead. This is my Raymond.
That's your brother.
Who's that?
Since you've been gone, terrible woman. I told Raymond she was no good.
The fun part of the video for me, though, was going from a young a young person in the video to an older person and playing such a drastic age difference. I think that was the fun part. Although it was very tedious having to sit there in makeup for that long a time. It was like, you mean I'm going to have to sit through makeup for 3.5-4 hours to get this makeup on to look like my grandmother. Great. And after a while, it gets to, you know, drying and drawing up, and it starts itching, and then have to take it all off. That was the hard part, but thank goodness I only had to do it one day.
Reba held up incredibly well, given the set of circumstances of the discomfort of the prosthetics, the heat buildup underneath, the exhaustion that the toll that wearing that kind of stuff for hours at a time, and then going into all the physicality for the backstory, she did remarkably well. And I mean, I have to hand it to her. She is a pro, and she's as much of an actress as she is a vocal performer.
It just hurts to remember.
There's a real strong reason why that's when Georgia's not in my show anymore, is because with all the shootings and things at school, I could not stand up on stage and sing the song about me killing my brother's wife. I thought that was giving out a wrong message. Although it's a wonderful song. And if those events hadn't happened, it'd probably still be in my show. But I didn't feel comfortable singing that.
Let me see if I got this straight.
We create this mystery about a woman who had gotten away with murder.
To protect you.
Who years later, when she was in her 80s, and a reporter came to talk to her, confessed and told the story of those crimes. And in it, we recreated the guilt that she carried with her for most of her life.
The ending is totally different in the video because she is confessing to this reporter that she did kill her husband's wife,
sister,
because she was cheating on him and she didn't like that. She was taking care of her brother, although her brother did hang for it. So that's, she felt very guilty about that.
Is the defense ready?
The defense is ready, Your Honor.
Fine. How about you, son? Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready, Your Honor.
And where is this Reba?
You know, I've always been a fan of Broadway shows before I ever got to go to a Broadway show because I could watch them in the old black and white movies, Doris Day movies, Judy Garland, Fred Astaire, and that dancing and singing and being in a setting, whether it was on a front porch or on a stage or whatever, putting those aspects together was something I always wanted to do. And then John Small came up with this video where I had dancers in a courtroom, and it worked out perfectly. And I thought it was cool. I worked with the choreographer, Jerry Evans, first time I'd ever met Jerry. And it was so much fun to get to do what I'd seen other people do. And I got to dance and sing at the same time. Probably the thing that surprised me most when I started working with Jerry is that I caught on to it so quickly. And I loved it. I mean, I'm not the type of person that likes to rehearse. You can ask anybody in my organization. Reba, we've been working here on these songs for 16,000 hours. You want to come work with us? Yeah, I'll sing it once with you. I'm ready to go. I mean, I'm not the type that likes to practice at all. So the dancing was something different than practice singing. And I thoroughly enjoyed doing it.
Some of these dance numbers, she would keep all the dancers in line. Because, you know, you do a take and then you break, the dancers would walk away. She'd get, okay, everybody back to one. She'd get you right there because she wanted to move along and just go, you know? And don't forget, it was a lot of stuff for her to do. It's not easy to sing and dance at the same time and try to remember all these things. And most people don't understand. She only learned it the day before.
It is hard for me to walk in pumps, much less dance in pumps. And then high heels are impossible. But yeah, it was hard for me to dance in them. You know, that opened up my eyes and Narvel's eyes to what we can do on stage by having all the dancers and this activity on a video. So we got to working with Jerry Evans and took those, some of the dancers, brought them on the road with us. So that was the reason we started off with having dancers on the road with us. You think you got a ticket and I must be some kind of fool. Well, when you have that many people involved in a dance routine, especially in a video, yes, it does take longer because, you know, whether my part was right or the camera angle, maybe a dancer was behind or not in its right place at a certain point where the camera passed by. So we had to do those kind of things over and over again. But for once, I didn't mind because I got to do some more dancing. John Small came up with the officer and a gentleman theme for this video, The Heart Won't Lie. And I am a sucker for romantic movies. I thought The Officer and Gentleman was an excellent movie. I thought it was very romantic, very touching, very sad. And so when John came up with this concept, we all fell in love with it.
But the words didn't come easily. So many times.
Vince's part was, he was like the drill sergeant, and I was one of the newcomers onto the team in boot camp. And so John did have to make him holler at me during the video, because at the beginning, he didn't want to. That's not his nature. And then he got into it. He liked it. That was not good. I think we were safe all the time, even through the mine explosion, the minefield blowing up. It was a special effect that John Small came up with. Although it was very loud and very effective, you know, I wasn't worried about it. I knew they'd protect us.
The special effects guy came up and said, so let me just go over this one more time for safety. As you're running through this minefield, if any of you catch on fire, don't run anymore. Just lay down and I'll put you out, you know. I had a couple of the extras mutiny on that one, you know, including Vince. We had to put Vince in one spot. He wouldn't run through it, you know. But Reba ran through it, right through the thing. And they were pretty dangerous.
The heart won't lie. Long after tonight.
It was a longer shoot than what we were used to. It was 3 days. Because we shot some scenes down at a cafe by the ocean. And then we went to the military base, which is not a military base anymore, and then we had to do the night scene. So it was long shoots, you know, early in the morning, late at night. I think it's a mind thing. You really have to keep psyching yourself up, you know, like, we got to do this, because if you get like, how many more scenes is it? How many more times do we have to do that scene? And that wears on everybody, the crew, the other actors, the director, yourself. So it's really important to keep a positive attitude from the very beginning and try to stay in a great mood.
When Reba was dry, he was wet. In fact, it took one time about 12 takes to get him to sing this one line. When Reba was behind the glass and they put their hand against the window, on his side, it was raining sideways, and it was probably about 30 degrees. And 11 of those takes, his teeth were chattering. He could not sing straight.
Probably beyond the video, she moves somewhere else, and he stays in training all the new recruits coming up. And I don't think they ever get together, you know. Even after the party, and it's very glamorous, and they're in their, you know, their white uniforms, everything looks so neat. I don't think they ever see each other after that. What do you think? This the ultimate revenge video of Does He Love You? This was the most fun video for me.
I've known about you.
I enjoyed playing the wrong woman who got revenge in the end. I thought it was a cool part to play. I didn't mind it at all. I've heard Patti LaBelle talk about that song, and she sings that song in her show, but she's not singing it with another woman. She said that just wouldn't happen. You know, I wouldn't put up with that at all. But I got a big kick out of singing it with Linda.
Is where he wants to be, but you're the
I have a big sister, one, and I know Reba has two sisters, but there's just something when we got together and all the times that we've, and the years that we've been friends, it's just a very natural friendship there that I could never put a price on, and it's very much like a sister. And she's been so supportive in everything I've done, whether it be personal or professional. And it's just real, real nice when you're an adult and you find somebody that you can relate to and identify with, and you have so much in common. We both have children, and so on a lot of different levels, she's very much like a big sister to me. I would not want to be on Reba's backside. I have never seen that in action, but that red hair scares me.
I also also, before we shot the video, had a skin cancer on my forehead that I was in L.A. and had to have removed. And so Sandy Spica, who's been with me over 10 years, she had to think of things and ways to cover this, because I had a huge Band-Aid on my head. And everybody was saying, well, why did you pick this time? Well, when is a good time, you know, to go have, you know, surgery on your forehead? Because we were busy throughout the whole year. And so Sandy had my hair going this way over my forehead. She had head pieces, you know, the pink lounging outfit with a headband and scarves and hats and everything. It was a very neat video because of the costuming alone.
Well, I'm not really proud of my role because I'm the other woman. I'm the mistress. And I get what I had coming to me. I got blown up in that boat. But it was one of those videos that I never took anybody seriously when they said, oh, Reba's going to blow you up in the boat. I thought, oh, this is just another joke. Somebody's pulling a prank on me. But she definitely blew me up.
I was doing the movie North, and so we were filming, just getting through with Does He Love You? And we needed the ending. We wanted it to be, we didn't want to leave it to where I just, you know, killed Linda Davis and my husband. So we worked it out for Rob Reiner while we were on the set of North for Linda to be there with me. And we were like looking on the little teleprompter. And we asked Rob if he would do it. He said, sure, I'll do it. He's the nicest, sweetest guy. So great to work with. And so at the very end, after the boat blows up, he says, see, there it goes, boom. And everybody's standing around the teleprompter, Linda and myself and Rob Reiner, just having a great time.
So the moment that, you know, sometimes that makes a video great, I mean, I had Rob Reiner in there. I had Linda Davis in there. Had all these great elements going on. But the moment that made the video great was a rollout in the film where I probably said cut and Reba just smiled at me. And that smile was the smile I used at the end of the video, just before this boat blew up.
Cut! Beautiful, Reba, come here. Take a look at this.
Boat, no, was sailing safely in the harbor. It was a little toy boat, a replica of the nice, beautiful boat. And it was a little bitty rascal, and it was so cute, just floating out the water, and they had little explosives, and they blew it up.
Dorothy, I think you're great.
I think you're great too, Brad.
Came from John Small, and I by far this is the funniest, silliest video I've ever shot. It's almost a slapstick comedy. It's got a lot of things on the cutting room floor that never made it to the video that are hysterical. The guy that plays the shampoo boy, he kept us in stitches the whole time. The bubble wigs, you know, the big bubble hairdos, they were like bubble wigs. And it was so much fun to get to work. And then we put the green stuff all over our face. And there was just, it was just comical to me. You know, I guess most people would say, Reba, I can't believe you did that. And then it's on film. But it was funny to me. I got a big kick out of doing it. And being another dance piece also, it turned it into almost a live Broadway show at one point with the top hat and the canes and the big hairdos. And it was a lot of fun.
I heard from you.
The imagination did get the better of this woman because she had an idea of what everything was going to be, and he had an idea of what everything was going to be. And unfortunately, they weren't the same. To me, baby, you can dial direct. I got call forward and call wait. You can even call collect. The service man, he told me that my favorite pampering thing to have done when I go to a beauty salon that has the full facility would be number one, a massage, and then a facial, and then a pedicure.
The song was fun and poppy, and I wanted to do a lot of different things. You know, she's waiting for this guy, and he hasn't called, and, you know, put her in a beauty parlor in a lot of different locations, a lot of different areas in the beauty parlor, made soap suds on her hair, and had her dance, and a little fancy here and there. And I think artists are great when they can actually make fun of themselves and show another side of themselves. She could be funny. She could. She had the sense of humor to make it work. She was great. A little Lucille Ball there.
Oh, the only part that was scary about showing a lot of the legs was in the high heels walking down the staircase. You know, that's always the scary part when you're trying to look like you're in control and you're not. But nah, that didn't bother me showing the legs. Got into shooting that first day, it was beautiful, little kids just everywhere. Be like a six-year-old little girl taking care of her, you know, one-year-old brother having, and we'd look around for where's the parents, but it was a community where everybody watched everybody's kids, and the kids watched after the kids.
Thousands of people live in this town, and I had to run into him.
I was just a fair, complected, red-headed woman. To them, that was unusual enough. And so I was sitting over there doing my lip liner and my lipstick, and they'll be right here watching me. And I'm really looking at them. You know, they're just grinning, those big grins. And I got them to sing E-I-E-I-O with me one time when we were waiting for them to set the lighting up. And it was just as sweet as it could be. We got back on the bus, and everybody's high-fiving, and they got on the bus with us, and they said, now, if by chance you are stopped by bandits, if there's something you don't want to part with, hide it now.
We originally wanted to shoot in Africa, but we chose Guatemala as our second choice because of the lush jungle, the beautiful lakes that we had around us. We had an infinite amount of photographic possibilities. The hotel where we shot a lot of our scenes were stepped down right towards the water with old fishermen kind of going by. And the texture of the place from the town, the small town itself, and its dusty kind of adobe quality to the lush greens of the coffee fields. An absolutely beautiful location. It was a little piece of paradise.
Well, the background story of Van Steele is two people meet, and they hadn't seen each other for a long time, and they strike up a conversation, and she still has the same feeling for him as she did many years ago. And then, as they're having dinner, this woman and a child walks in, and it's his family. And she comes to the realization that he's been busier than she thought. And so she stays, and he goes away to be, you know, to continue his medicine work somewhere else, and she stays in that village to continue her work.
I think Reba is one of the rare entertainers. She's not only a recording artist, but she has innate acting ability. And she has the ability not only to put over her song as an actress, but she can stand on her own as an actress.
When I first saw the video, I was just ecstatic. I loved the what Jack captured on the film, what he captured with the children and the people there, and the story was wonderful. When I was listening to On My Own, and they said, let's turn this in from a duet to a quartet, I said, who would you like to sing with? And I said, well, of course, Linda. Linda's my singing partner, and I've always been a huge fan of Martina and Tricia, and we're all good friends, so I thought, man, this would be a blast to get to do a video and sing a song, go in the recording studio, and get to work with these three wonderfully talented, beautiful women. And so we did.
Said our love would always be true.
And then we went out to Los Angeles and shot the video. And we were in the Charlie Chaplin Studios out in Los Angeles, and the history involved there, and all of us. The only problem with shooting the video was they kept saying, girls, girls, we're ready to shoot now. Quiet on the set. And it wasn't anybody on the set that was making noise, just us, because we were visiting, having a great time. It's very hard to find the time to get to set and visit with other females in the business, males in the business, because unless you're touring together or you're at the award shows or like this, doing a video shoot together, it's almost impossible to get to see each other unless you make specific time. And then it's chances are it's going to be very slim that we're both off the road at the same time.
And you were in.
Especially, I really did think it was this very special event to bring four ladies in the music business together in one song. And I was so glad they agreed to it. And we also got to do it on the awards show. It meant so much to me that they said yes. They could have said no. It was extra work for them. It was my single. It was time out of their downtime, their time they could have spent at home, that they came and did this with me. Poker player. I beat them all. I cheated, of course, but don't tell them that.
While the camera was rolling, we tried to get in a card game, and, you know, I kind of felt obligated to let her win since it was her video.
This is not a typical country song, but that's never really even entered my thinking when I'm trying to find a song to record. I'm a big fan of music. I like all different kinds of music. And I grew up listening to country music. But there's only two kinds of music for me, and that's good and bad. And I try to stay away from the bad, and I try to stick with the good.
I just think she's tops. And all the chances that I have to spend time with her, I do, because she's just one of my favorite people. And I treasure all the times that we have spent together.
So doing a song like On My Own told a great story. And for us four women to be able to sing the same song. And then we took it on the road the next year by bringing Trisha and Martina via video, and with Linda and I singing it live on stage. So it worked out very well. It was almost theatrical on stage. It was the song we had selected for the next single. off this album. And for some reason or another, after we shot the video down at St. Simon's Island in Georgia, we were almost ready to release the whole package. And Narvel and I just didn't feel right about that being that single at that time, and wanted to come with I'd Rather Ride Around With You. So at the last minute, we call MCA and say, we've changed our mind. We want to go with I'd Rather Ride Around With You. You know, it's a summer song, it's fun, it's we just want to change our mind. And they said, well, okay. Well, we had to go back down to, we had to shoot another video. So we thought, well, it'd be a pretty cool idea to do a prequel instead of a sequel. And so we just kind of flip-flopped it and had the same director, same leading man, everybody go back down to St. Simon Island, Georgia, and shoot I'd Rather Ride Around With You. The only problem that I had was, it was the year after I'd broken my leg, and I was still in therapy. I'd broken my knee snow skiing in 96. So it was in 97, and I had to, you know, like push the truck out of the sand and do some, you know, fast walking, helping her carry her bridal gown and train and everything into the church. So that was the only problem I had. Everything else went pretty fine. Rather Ride Around With You is what happens in chronological order. It happens first. That's when we're young and in love. And What If It's You is what happens years later.
I've got something to tell you that I just can't say. So I'm writing it down in case maybe someday our lives take a turn down a road we can't see right now.
Well, it was the first time I'd worked with Jerry Winter, and it was also the first time I'd worked with a director who had also written the piece and who was also the DP, director of photography. So it was very interesting. He had it all in his mind. He knew what he wanted to see because he had written it. And so he's great to work with. And to get to go back and do I'd Rather Ride Around With You, kind of a prequel thing, it all blended very well together.
What if it's you?
Buckley is a sweetheart to work with. He was so much fun, easygoing, added so much to the video with his huge smile, with his twinkle in his eye, and his great personality. He didn't say a word in the videos, but you could see what he was thinking. He was so much fun to do the video with. And when we went back to do I'd Rather Ride Around With You, of course, Andy had to be in the video again. And consequently, well, it is so funny, years later, I do a video for Forever Love, and that becomes a movie. And who is playing my best friend's husband but Andy? He went and tried out and got the part. I was thrilled to death to get to work with him again. Cutting my hair for probably 3 years. Narvel and Sandy and I had already been talking about it, when would be a good time to do it, and it was something I really felt strong about. I really wanted to cut my hair off because I had had it since before Shelby was born, and when I was pregnant with Shelby with all the prenatal vitamins and everything, I mean, it just got huge and it got too big, and so it was definitely time in 96 to cut it off. I think it was a typical Reba video or a typical Rooks and Dunn video. It was totally different. It was kind of like something from both of our video types. I think Deaton and Flanagan did a wonderful job intertwining the two styles and made everybody happy. And that's a chore.
If you see
my first time getting to work with Deaton and Flanagan on a video project, and it went very smoothly. We shot the ballroom scene in a college over in Lebanon, and then the next day we shot in downtown Nashville at a restaurant, and it went real smoothly, and I was very pleased with the results of the video. It was a lot of fun to get to work with Ronnie and Kix in the video aspect.
If you see,
it was very intimidating, you know, because Reba came in and she was like, you know, I guess it would be compared to like Elvis, you know, when he used to do his movies and stuff. They said he would show up and he'd know everybody's lines.
Yeah. And we get a camera and a couple of pretty girls and go, what are we going to do?
Tell her I'm doing fine.
We shot down on 2nd Avenue where there's tons and tons of people sitting around and screaming and yelling, and we were recording audio. So it took a lot of time.
I think also that it was a challenge because Brooks and Dunn has their own distinctive style as far as video is concerned, and then so does Reba. So you didn't want it to necessarily look just like a Reba piece or a Brooks and Dunn. So you kind of had to come up with a blended kind of video where it felt like both of their videos.
Of the video is that Reba has left, you know, this one guy portrayed by me, and is taking, you know, his best friend and her friend into confidence, you know. And people interpret it in many different ways.
Like, well, she, what was going on?
Well,
she
yeah.
She left the one guy, you, and she was picking up the other guy.
See, now that's how Kix would interpret it, see? So it's open for all kinds of debate. You know, we really
debate?
Don't know what's
that's
going
what was
on.
Going on. Believe the stuff she was telling me at that table. I'm afraid Narvel's going to find out.
Please. We'll get to him later. That was a problem. Narvel was a problem with this video.
The Inquirer gets a hold of this. We're dead.
Narvel was all over us.
Reba is probably one of the best artists we've worked with just because she has so many good people behind her. Her management company, the people that work with her, her makeup people, her stylists, the label. She's just like top notch, and just she comes prepared. She's ready to go. Just tell her when to be there. You know, she's just the best.
She's the ultimate professional.
Absolutely.
She is absolutely terrific to work with.
Situation, you got to talk about it. You got to get the conversation going. Communication is the key. And if they don't, it's going to go by the wayside. And it's a shame.
If you see her,
all right, man.
See you, man. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, I'll see you later.
Hey, it's all right with you. Let's keep that stuff in there between me and you.
Hey, don't worry about it.
Okay.
I'll see you later. Hey, hello.
Hey, glad I caught you.
You know what we were talking about earlier today?
Yeah.
Can we just keep that between ourselves?
Sure.
Thanks. I appreciate you.
I'll see you later.
Okay. Bye. A script called Always and Forever, and fell in love with it, and we were going to film it out in California. It was a CBS television movie of the week, and it was a great love story. Tim Matheson, Bess Armstrong was in the movie, and Tim Matheson and I portray a woman who in real life was in a coma for 30 years and is still alive today. I portray her, and I go into a coma for 20 years. And when I wake up, of course, everything's changed. And so right in the middle of this, filming this movie, three of my writers at Starstruck who have read the script write this song called Forever Love. And in midstream, we change the name of the movie, I record the song, and we retitle it as Forever Love.
Forever love, I won't give up.
Tim Matheson is a very great actor, in my opinion. He's very business. He's also a director. So he was always, when it was not his time to be in front of the camera, he was back behind watching, asking questions. So he was very into the business all the time. Just very easy to get along with.
Minutes and hours and years may go by.
I'd heard about this movie and I'd heard about a movie with Reba, and, you know, and I had always been a big fan of hers since Tremors. You know, I'm a big sci-fi movie nut, and so I'd heard about the movie, and I said, you know, I'd love to work with her. And then when the movie finally was set up and it came about, I saw the script, and, you know, with her attached, and the script didn't really mean so much to me as the opportunity to, you know, to work with Reba, play love scene with Reba, and sing to Reba. So I just jumped all over it, you know, it was great.
To have a video that has pieces of a movie that can be mixed in with it. We did the movie, of course, first, and then that was going to be the first single off the album with the movie. It was the greatest package. It was just a godsend. And then the video, having a little bit of the movie involved with it, it was just perfect.
She has the ability to entertain people and to give that great voice, you know, and her soul to people. And I don't mean to, you know, to get carried away, but when you have a gift like that, it's your obligation, really, to, you know, present it in the best capacity that you can.
Well, at the end of Forever Love, my husband and I are just really trying to work things out. We're getting our daughter married. And at the wedding, before the wedding, she decides it's not going to happen. He's not the one she wants to marry. And we have this huge reception, this big party here, and he says, well, it's a shame to let this great, the preacher's here, and it's great for this party to go to waste. He said, let's get remarried. And I say, okay. And so we get remarried and walk out and dance in the rain like we did the first time we got married. Cowboys and with Jerry Jones and everybody affiliated with the halftime program there on Thanksgiving Day at the Dallas Cowboy game had asked me to perform a song at halftime. And the Salvation Army and the Dallas Cowboys have had a great long-lasting relationship, and they wanted this to be the kickoff for the kettle drive for the Salvation Army.
You know,
we didn't have the perfect song to sing. And so Norman had the idea of calling Diane Warren. And we called Diane, and just because I'd been out there to listen to some songs of hers and been a huge fan forever. And she said, I've got the perfect song. And she started singing the song to Narvel over the telephone. And he said, well, that's great. Reba will want to hear it. Please, can you send us a tape, a cassette of it? She said, oh, sure, sure. So we got the song in, and the next day, I mean, she put it in the mail immediately. And it was What If. And the song was perfect for what we were looking for. It was wonderful to be able to stand in the middle of that huge circle of people all around me, and the video capturing, the camera capturing that image of everybody joining together. So we went in and recorded it, and I sang it at the halftime program at the Dallas Cowboy game on Thanksgiving Day. And that was a great kickoff for the cattle drive for the Salvation Army. And then I went in and did the video for it. And all the proceeds of the video, the single, everything went to the Salvation Army. Diane agreed, MCA agreed, and I agreed. And it was a huge success. The song in itself could have stood on its own. But to have those images of the strife and conflict going on around the world, the children holding up the little signs, that was very touching. But it was a very positive message. On the other hand, we can do this. If we all join together, we can make this a better place to live. A song I fell in love with because it's another story song, and we got Deaton and Flanagan to write a concept. Before they'd written a concept, though, Narvel had pretty much had in his mind what the way he wanted to see it, and we got Narvel was really strong on the point that this could be the mother of the teenager and the young son, and I said, oh my gosh, no, she's too young to have cancer. Well, we have just gone through a terrific, horrendous episode of my best friend from first grade to 12th grade having breast cancer. And then Narvel says, Sherry's same age as you are. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what am I thinking? Cancer is something that will affect all age groups, unfortunately. And that's what Narvel really wanted to bring home in this video. And I think that's what, unfortunately, people can relate to when they watch it.
Till she was three sheets to the wind.
She's always changed the way we look at videos. She's definitely a video artist.
Well, I think she looks at it as entertainment. And with entertainment comes emotion. And that's what she wants to do. She wants to move people emotionally, whether it be with a comedy or a drama or whatever. But they do not like doing just what we call like fluff pieces, where it's, you know, you just put out a video just to put it out. There has to be a reason. There has to be entertainment value and emotion.
I was going to be the storyteller. I'm the narrator. This song carried it. It was carrying the whole video. And that great actors, it didn't need me in it, anything to be more than just the storyteller.
Her every breath is weaker than the last. And lately when she sleeps, she talks about the past.
Yeah, and the actual ending to the piece really wasn't the exact ending that Narvel had written or wanted to do, because they wanted to have her lip sync that very last line. And we had thought maybe that wasn't the right thing to do, so what we did is we thought of another idea, but they weren't on the set yet, so we were going to pitch it to them at dinner.
There was a lot of discussion, actually.
Yeah.
And we thought, well, we'll just go ahead and shoot it and then see, and then play it back and see if we liked it. And we did it one time and looked at it back, and Narvel was like, absolutely, this is the way it should be.
The finished video, when it was shown to everyone, there was not a dry eye in the house, men and women both. The shows, we run this video in our show while I'm singing, and once again, I'm the storyteller, and the video is there behind me. I can't turn around and look at it either. I mean, it's life, and life hurts, and there's not a dry eye in the house. You know, I got a call yesterday about a young lady in California who has just found out she has leukemia. And I call her. What do you say? We had good friends that lost their 16-year-old son. We go to their house. What do you say? You can't say nothing. Like I said to Garth when he lost his mom, I said, Garth, I don't have any words of wisdom. I don't have anything that'll make you feel better. I just want you to know I care. Because there's not a dad blame thing you can say. I guess I do feel like a video pioneer. I mean, starting off in 1984, 85, and consistently having videos with my singles. I think it's very important. I think it's a great promotional tool. I think it's an added bonus for our fans. I think they deserve it. They've stayed with me through thick and thin, through over 20 years in the music business. And when I first got to do a video, it was like a thrill for me to be able to give them something extra, something more. Yes, it does cost a lot of money to do a video, but that video will be around forever. And I think it's very important to do a high quality, very good message video, because it will be around forever, and you want something that you're going to be proud of.
This one takes a whole different course. It's taking Reba from like 6 years old to present day. So in the middle of the video, you don't really realize what you're watching, but you're watching Reba go from six to present day.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, today it's a beautiful day in February. We're shooting a video. It's my brand new single that's soon to be released, called I'll Be. Diane Warren's song that I fell in love with. And that's the house I grew up in. That is the concept of this video. Me growing up, my childhood in this house and with my parents. And it's a very moving song, and so it's a very moving video. Right now they're filming me going off to college when I was a young girl.
The whole idea is just to kind of show how life evolves, how life changes, and how your parents take care of you, and then eventually roles reverse, and you end up taking care of them, hopefully. And it's kind of about that, about life and how it changes.
Yeah, in the video, I have a very young me, little girl, 7 years old, and then a young girl that's plays me from about 12, and then going to college, and then getting married, and then I come in to the picture. So it's different stages, different ages, and kind of tells the story of the house, I think, is what it is. The memories of the house and what's going on in the house and how we relate to what's going on in my life.
And it's an older home, so it photographs really nice, and it's got that classic feel, and we just felt like it lended itself to the story. And a lot of the story revolves around the house, and yeah, that, you know, the furniture changes, and the people grow up, and you see how the house, you know, gets older, and the house almost becomes a character in the piece.
Yeah, it does. It actually takes on its own little piece, and the house actually goes from 1963 to present day.
Well, it's been fun running through all of the past videos I've gotten to do here on Video Bio, and so now, why don't we watch the brand new one? It's called I'll Be. Thanks for all your support and watching me throughout the years, and here's the brand new one.
your shelter when you need someone to see you through. I'll be there to carry you.
One of the most consistent people that I've ever been around. And to me, consistency means everything, because you can expect tomorrow what you had today. And what I always saw in Reba was a very caring and honest person.
I can remember the thoughts that I had when I walked up on stage to sing those shows with Reba McEntire. I mean, there was part of me going, buddy, you're a newcomer here, and I can't believe I'm on this stage singing with her, you know? And it was hard for me to overcome. Even you know, she worked so hard to be, you know, to level the playing field for us and stuff. And I can remember being on the plane with her and stuff and going, God dang, I'm in a plane with Reba McEntire. I really did, man. You know, I come from Oklahoma. That's, you know, she's big stuff.
I tend to think that Reba looks for perfection. I am a perfectionist myself, and the fact that she chose me to do some of her landmark videos makes me feel a sense of pride that our reach, where we were both reaching for, was the same place.